Hey guys, welcome to Grad Coach TV, where we demystify and simplify the oftentimes confusing world of academic research. My name's David, and today I'm chatting with one of our trusted dissertation coaches, Peter, about five of the common mistakes students make when working on their abstracts. This discussion is based on one of the many, many articles over at the Grad Coach blog. So if you're looking for more information about the abstract or any of your other chapters, consider taking a look at the Grad Coach blog. You can find it at gradcoach.com/blog. Also, if you're looking for a helping hand with your thesis, dissertation, or research project, consider taking a look at our one-on-one private coaching service, where we will help you step-by-step through your research journey, providing support and holding your hand. For more information and to book a free consultation with one of our friendly coaches, head over to gradcoach.com. So, Peter, welcome to the CoachCast. It's great to have you here with us today.
Great to be here. I'm excited.
So today we're talking about the abstract mistakes. And the first one is really about not understanding what an abstract is. So when there's that misunderstanding, we often enough see a lot more problems coming up. So, Peter, what is an abstract and how do we make it?
I think the best way to think about an abstract is to consider how abstracts are used in the research process. You've probably seen a lot of abstracts or read a lot of abstracts in the process of doing research. They are meant to be very concise summaries of the research that has been carried out. And it includes a little bit of everything about the research so that anyone who's considering reading it has a good idea of what they're going to find. Besides the title, it's going to be the second thing that they see in the library database. I like to compare it to an elevator pitch. You want to keep it short, sweet, and not waste the reader's time, but represent everything that you're aiming in your research to get across. It's important to recognize that an abstract is standalone. It needs to function separate from the research in that you don't want to be copying and pasting from your work. The idea is that you're creating a narrative about the research that represents everything that you did.
That's a great explanation there, Peter. And as you said, it is that first bit of a research piece that we read. And we're going to be using that to make a decision on whether we're going to read that article or not. And it's also there to give your marker an idea of what you're going to be exploring in your research. One of the common things that comes up is there's a bit of a misconception about what an abstract is. And we'll talk about the contents of an abstract later on, but it really isn't just the summary of your intro or the summary of your discussion. As you said, Peter, it's a little bit of everything. It is your intro, your literature review, your methodology, what you found and what it means. And so it's really important to keep all of those together. It's also a standalone document, as you mentioned. So we don't want to be presenting any new information at all. It really needs to be what it's presenting is what is in your paper.
Absolutely. I think that's fantastic. Those are such common misconceptions. The last thing that I want to talk about is comparing the talking about the difference between an executive summary and an abstract. Largely, the only difference is length. In an executive summary, you have a little bit more space to work with. It can be more along the lines of 1,000 words rather than something much shorter. An abstract is considered to be a half a page to a page work, very concise. Some disciplines prefer executive summaries. Some disciplines prefer abstracts. It's best to check with your program. And I'm certain that they generally have a recommendation on what is expected as part of the project.
So mistake number two is not covering the key parts of your study. So Peter, what all do we need to put into our abstract?
You know, generally, I think the best way to think about it is an abstract tells us what you did, why you did it, and how you did it. Those are the three sort of questions that you should have in the back of your mind as you're preparing your abstract. The other way and perhaps an easier rule of thumb is that 2 to 3 sentences from each of your chapters need to be included. What you're looking to do is tell us who and where you did your research. It's basically the same idea as chapter one. You're contextualizing for us the research that you undertook. The why question is about the significance of the research. How does it connect to what research came before, and what differences that you use to justify your research? Again, you know, in a few sentences, it's really important to keep this concise. So you're not adding new information here. You're just telling us very briefly what the significance of the research was. Then you would want to tell us a little bit about the design. I see this often where people will try to replicate the whole of their design, and that's not useful either. We just need to know what your methodology was and a few key points. Something about the sample would be very helpful, because that has a lot to do with the implications of your research. Who was it that you worked with, and how many? These are sorts of the questions that you'd want to include in your abstract. And then the big findings and the implications. We're not going to try to replicate all of your findings, but what were the key ones that perhaps were unexpected, or that may have been complementing existing research? Think about it in that way, so that you're telling us as an audience, is this something that we can read and expect to uncover new information, or something that we should pay attention to, maybe your literature review more closely because your findings complement what's already in your literature review? These are the ways to think about your abstract. It's the what, the why, and the how, and try to be as concise as possible.
I think that's really a great coverage of it. And I'm so glad that you use the same rule of thumb that I do of, you know, 2 to 3 sentences per chapter. Really, as you said, Peter, here, it's totally about what you did, why you did it, how you did it. And let's be honest, the most important part most people reading your research are interested in is what you found. Definitely really helpful there, Peter. So the third mistake we come across, and it's one that kind of gets under my skin a little bit, is when in the abstract, students or clients are actually just copy-pasting from their chapters rather than paraphrasing and creating their abstract. So Peter, why is this an issue in writing an abstract?
Well, I find that what happens is that since an abstract is meant to be written last, it's one of the last things that you do because you want to be able to summarize all of your work, that there is this tendency to copy and paste. They take directly from what they've already written in the dissertation as if that is going to be sufficient for concisely representing what they did. And so this is the wrong way to think about the abstract. It shouldn't be a copy and paste job. It needs to paraphrase. It needs to represent in very clear language, very detail-rich language, what the main components are of your research, as we've already discussed. It's really important to be able to read an abstract that has a smooth flow, a clear narrative about what it was you set out to do and how well you actually accomplished what you set out to do. And then what are the results? Sometimes those results may not be what you expected, or they may not be earth-shattering in your opinion, but the abstract really represents the first picture that someone who is arriving at your work is the first picture that they're going to get of this work. And it can really make a big difference in whether or not they're going to go ahead and read the rest of your document.
I think that's definitely a key point. You really want that really strong narrative, because as you said earlier, Peter, when you see a good abstract, it makes an impact. It sort of helps you to sit up and say, oh, thank goodness, I finally found that study I've been looking for. So really having a clear narrative from the first few sentences all the way through to the end is really useful, making sure that narrative flow is clear, and probably most importantly is using detail-rich, concise language. We want to make sure we're maximizing the amount of information we can present while minimizing word count, but still telling a good story, which is a pretty tough line to walk, but that's, I guess, why we do it right at the end as well. So mistake four is related to various formatting and language issues. And this is a bit of a catch-all for quite a range of small mistakes that come up. So Peter, what are some of these issues that we need to keep an eye out for when writing an abstract?
There are a number of common rules to follow. One, no new content. You don't want to surprise your reader or provide your reader with some sort of expectations of something that's going to be included, and then you don't touch on it at all in your research. Another rule is you don't need to include citations. You don't want to reference anything within the abstract. You may use names, let's say, if you've used a named theory, or if your research is somehow in response to a particular researcher or set of researchers, you may name those sorts of people, but you won't be doing any sort of referencing of their work. Another rule is excessive jargon. We don't want to be using lots of jargon in an abstract. You want it to be understandable to a general audience. You want it to be expressing in concise ways what your research is about. But by being too much or using too much jargon, you can lose your reader. The reader may not be able to understand exactly what you're talking about. Related to that, you don't want to be using abbreviations. You probably use quite a few abbreviations in your dissertation or thesis, but in the abstract, those need to be spelled out. You just don't have the space to provide a lot of information here in your abstract, and expecting someone from who's just coming to your research to understand what an abbreviation is expecting too much, let's say. The other rule of thumb is you don't want to include figures, tables, or bullet points. You want to be concise, but not in the way that perhaps a list would provide that sort of conciseness. So those are the sorts of rules that apply to an abstract. Becomes a very nice flowing narrative.
I think that's a really great coverage there. Most of those issues. I think the one thing that I would add is it's really important to be aware of the length of your abstract. And this can vary quite a lot. So some journals have very short abstracts, 100, 180 words, whereas in a dissertation or PhD, you might have 500 words or more for an abstract. So it's really important to keep in mind you're telling a narrative story, but you've got to do that within a word count. And the best way to find that out is to go to your university to get those specifics. Similarly as well, different universities have different many rules or suggestions. So I always suggest go take a look at your university guidelines, the information that you have there. They will tell you about the specific formatting steps that they want you to follow. So definitely it's worthwhile to go check out those documents as well. So our fifth and final mistake is not including keywords at the end of your abstract. This is a little bit of an uncertain one because some universities don't require it. But Peter, maybe you can let us know why including keywords is important and what we can do to identify them.
I think the best way to talk about keywords or key phrases is to understand the value that they enter into the research process. Keywords are the ways in which other researchers find your work. You went through this process in finding the research that you used in your literature review, and now determining some keywords for your own project will help other researchers find your work. It's really important to understand that there is a difference, or that there can be a difference. When we say keywords or key phrases, there might be multiple words that represent a concept, or so you don't want to just limit yourself as far as like one word keywords. They can represent multiple or a larger concept and have multiple terms. Of course, you wouldn't, I don't want to take this to the extreme where someone is using a whole sentence as a keyword or a key concept. That's not the case. Another good aspect to recognize is that there is 5 to 7 words would probably be sufficient. If you start to have too many keywords, then it seems as if you're gaming the system, or that your work is going to lack credibility. We call them keywords because these are the most important concepts or ideas that you're going to be sharing with us in your research. And overdoing it can be a problem. The most important aspect of deciding on which keywords to use is that there is a strong alignment with the key elements of your research project. If you've been using Grad Coach videos, I'm sure you've heard the word alignment often. We talk about it quite a lot because it's important to connect all of the aspects of your research together and recognize that there is this relationship. And keywords are no different. Keywords are meant to represent the key elements of your research.
I think that's a great point, that we really want that alignment to be strong in our abstract so that we're moving from the keywords or key phrases you're using in your abstract are seen in your study itself and are used as your keywords. I think another thing to think about is how do you decide on what your keywords or key phrases are? And broadly speaking, the best way to go about this is to look at what's being used by other research that's very similar to yours. That would be the first way. And then secondly, what are the key concepts or key ideas that are integral to your project? So you really want to make sure that you're catching those key topics. And as Peter said, you've only got 5 to 7 to choose from. So it's important to be a little careful on that. Lastly, I will say as well, for any of these keywords or key phrases, again, do take a look at what your university requirements are, because some universities don't want them, others want 3. So really just err on the side of what's been published before through your university by looking at other dissertations. All right, so that's a wrap on today's episode of Grad Coach TV. Remember, if you're looking for more information about the abstract or any of your other chapters, head over to our blog at gradcoach.com/blog. There you can also get access to our free dissertation and thesis writing mini course, which gives you all the information you need to get started on your research journey. Also, if you're looking for a helping hand in your dissertation or thesis, be sure to check out our one-on-one private coaching service, where you can work with one of our friendly coaches like Peter. For all the information and to book a free initial consultation, head over to gradcoach.com. Well, that's all we have time for today. Until next time, good luck.